I think the first most important is how important to have teacher. Basically, when I give an answer more general level, when you learn something good qualities or bad qualities, good influence or bad influence, you need to have friendship. So because of that reason, when you have a good teacher or a good dharma, good friends, you learn good things, like you have good parents, for example, and they give you good examples, like not fighting each other always, giving respect. Then you get automatically impact without you knowing that you need to behave like that somehow. Now you have a bad parents, I should not say bad parents, but bad relationship. Yeah? Good parents, but bad relationships. Then you always see, you know, you impact by that. Similarly, when you come to spiritual, you need to have teacher, because you cannot learn things by yourself in normally. You need a teacher. So just in example, studying normal education, you need a teacher. ABCD, you need to have teacher. So it's a very, I don't need to explain so deep why you need it for teacher. Now for, especially for practitioner, spiritual, you need more important. Now more than that, not only just spiritual, particularly in the Dharma practitioner, you need to have teacher. Because the teacher has the experience, teacher has some knowledge, the teacher actually learned the knowledge and experience from his teacher. Had. So you imagine that thousands of years of collective the experiences and the wisdoms that becomes, you know, helps you to understand. That's why you need teacher. Like you can go study a book and you go to class and you read the book. It's different. You can read a book, you think you can understand, but you go to class, then you read a book, then you understand more than not going to class. So particularly in Buddhism is very important. Now, what kind of teacher, what kind of quality with teacher is very important. So in the Buddhist teachings, they always talk about finding the right teacher, not just by your feelings or I like or I don't, not only just like that. You need to learn about the quality of the teaching, teacher. The quality of teacher is basically knowing the quality of Dharma. Just give very simple. What is Dharma means? The Dharma should be live life on the person. Then that becomes the quality of the teacher. Okay. Of course, in this Jhonimal Liberation that I'm going to talk, they give you some description of the quality of teachers. But then the practitioner self, means the student self, is very important. Now, how much you get further in the spiritual path depend on what, how you can go far. Dharma actually can go very far, but does not mean you can go far. So your relationship towards yourself, your relationship towards Dharma, your relationship with your teacher, your relationship with others, Dharma brothers and sisters, practitioners, is depend on you being how you want to live, how you want to practice, how you want to integrate your Dharma into your life. That is really is the thing. You know? So I think it's very important. So you need to find out what quality that you have as a student or as a practitioner. For me, practitioner means knowing the quality of Dharma, finding and to try to get that Dharma quality in you, try to become a living, you know, alive. Then that is a student quality. Now the devotion part is the one of the quality. The one of the quality of how far you can go. So you have a devotion, like a very common devotion. I like my teacher. He's a nice person. So you can go that far, that particular far of Dharma. Oh, my teacher is very good. I think he's a really Superman. You know? Not enlightened, but Superman. He's much better than any else. Okay, you can go that far. Oh, my teacher is exact Buddha. You can go that far. My teacher is inseparable of all the Buddhas that actually exist or the Dharmakaya, the most pure level, nature level, not differences. Then you can go that far. So devotion is just one quality of a practice, that how you can go deep and how you can go far. Like compassion. Oh, I have pity to people. Simple compassion. I like to help people how much I can. Moderate compassion. I want to help all beings. Quite good compassion. I'm so suffer to have that compassion. You have very bad compassion. Bad compassion. I want to help all beings, but I don't see all beings absolutely existed. They not realize the true nature. Then themselves is actually not exist, but they don't realize that. It's like a dream. Everybody's dreaming, but they don't know they are dreaming. And your effort of helping is not solid. You don't go into suffering because you don't see solid suffering. Now that compassion becomes quite deep. So compassion is the second quality for a practitioner. Now how deep you want to go, that is depend on how you can push. How, not really push, but how able to practice. So, you see, the devotion is one part of the quality. Yeah? The devotion is the part of the devotion has a lot of factors, a lot of different qualities to find out. Right? Likewise, compassion has a lot of different qualities. Compassion is not just one small feeling. Okay? So, I think it's very important. So you ask me a question to give you a true answer. You really, my answer is going to be depend on the person. So person who asking that question, you are really serious to practice well. You really want to practice moderate and a truthful practitioner. You don't want to go to the any doubts and, you know, this and that kind of academic questions debate or that kind of level, but you really want to be really true practitioner, then I think it's very important to have a teacher and very important to have a devotion. But the teacher knows, you should all know. Teacher knows to have a student who have pure devotion is 1 million in is one. In 1 million, you can find only one. I tell you a story. They have one great master. He said to one student, ask this student to come. He sent one monk. Student come up, student sleeping. He said, why teacher calling me? Are you lying to me? No, it's really true. Rinpoche is waiting for you. Then he looked up to the mount at the monastery. Rinpoche is walking up the baranda. So he see, Rinpoche is waiting. So he go up. He says, and Rinpoche asks the first question, do you have a devotion on me? Students say, yes. How much devotion you have? I say, I see you exact Buddha. He says, I know that, Rinpoche answer. Say, now I only give you one final bit instruction that I never gave to no one. Then he gave that to him. Now the Rinpoche passed away, that pith instruction he wanted to pass the Rinpoche's reincarnation. So the pith instruction is, you can sit here, meditate, and you can go to the Buddha field and to meet the Buddhas and receive the teachings from the Buddhas, then comes back. That fifth instruction. So just give an example. You know, is particular in the Buddhism, more important in the Vajrayana. Devotion is one of the most important factors. And to perfect devotion is a result of your practice. Devotion is not the practice only. Devotion is actually the result. So it's not like one time you do and you just pass. No, it's gradually improvement. Guru Rinpoche is the manifestation of the enlightened Buddha. When I say enlightened Buddha, I'm not only just saying enlightened Buddha Shakyamuni or Buddha for this, Buddha for that. I'm not talking about that. I say enlightened Buddha means every Buddha. Okay? So the story, this is Amitabha Buddha and Avalokiteshvara. But basically Guru Rinpoche is manifestation from the enlightened Buddha. And then he particular giving the teachings in the right time and right period of people. Especially he gave the teachings of the Vajrayana. And he is the one of the great Mahasiddha, Maha-realized master, that received the fifth instruction of Vajrayana. The particular, the secret eight deity combined together. They have eight masters who receive separate deities practice from Dakini in the one cemetery in India called Tutu Sivasa near the Buddhagaya cemetery. I think they call it Sivasa. It's okay. Then Guru Rinpoche is very unique. He's already enlightened, he achieved rainbow body, he achieved longevity. Because of he is a manifestation of enlightened one, we are never separated from him. Because our nature of our mind is a Buddha. So because of that reason, we never separated from that nature. Right? Now, Guru Rinpoche is a manifestation of that. So he never ends. His manifestations never ends. Nowadays, you know, how you relate to him. Guru Rinpoche, he didn't die. So the meaning is it's not a past tense. We have a many masters, we have past tense, you know. Like saying, when people died, you say, late this, late that, you know. Oh, late John, late Joe. Yeah? Guru Rinpoche, for us, we never give late Guru Rinpoche. Because Guru Rinpoche never passed away. So because of that reason, people who have 100% devotion, until now, Guru Rinpoche is present, as how he present in Tibet, 40 years he stay. So Guru Rinpoche is manifestations, Guru Rinpoche is a blessing, is actually much more alive until now. They have so many people. Of course, the people don't share. This is one thing you should know. In the Vajrayana, we don't like to share our experiences public. Because to share experiences to public is the condition to get people's judgment. Doubt comes up, dislikes comes up, like praise comes out. Telling experiences, that is the beginnings of your own downfall. So in Vajrayana, you don't see much in YouTube's, in Facebook saying that, oh, this supernatural thing happened, this miracle thing. Actually, I'm telling you, the miracle happening, every single experiences I met, my colleagues, they have so many stories. Like, you cannot tell. I give you short, this is not my experience, okay? It's a, like a very general experience that I like to share with you. In the mountain in Nepal, they call a place called Nubri. It's a very near to Tibet border. In that time, 11 month, meaning the December, it's all going to be snow, water all going to be freeze, everything going to be, how you say, basically winter, yeah? They're all frost, okay? So they have a third Chogyam Rinpoche, the Nenden Chogyam Rinpoche, went to there. They did Drupchen. But that Drupchen is not like normal Drupchen, like 9 days, okay? They took almost over 1 month because they did the preparing, reading the sutras, because Drupchen you can do many different periods of time, but that particular is over 1 month. So they read the whole Buddha's scripture, they did the sangha, they did the fire puja, then they began Drupchen. So basically, when they become end part of the Drupchen, when you receive the blessings out, because you keep the blessing in for 1 month and practice, then you want to take out the blessing to give to the, all the public. Before that happening, the heat, you know, the whole area start melting. I'm not talking about the house or monastery, okay? I'm talking about the whole mountain, the whole, basically everything changing. Melt, snow melt, frost gone, heat comes up, grass become green, flower blooms in December in that mountain area. So that everybody experiences. Okay, so now I give you my example. This is I want to share with you because it's not my personal, okay? It's more public. But nobody knows, so I tell you that one. So I know that story. So I heard that story. Naju Gumba Drupchen, we did this year, 2015, end of the 2015, right? Naju Gumba Drupchen. So it's quite cold this year. Then I remember that story. One day I talked with that older monk about that story. So I think, you know, tomorrow is our Drupchen ending. So I like to see a little bit, you know. I don't like to see, but like to see, kind of, you know, everybody, you battle yourself, you know. This is the practice means. You always have expectation, you see. You always tell yourself, don't do it, but you always had it. That's why you need to have a sincere practice. Because in the Vajrayana, how much you expect, that is actually the hope with attachment. How much you have a hope in attachment, that much you have self-judgment. You see, people really, we know this is wrong. We know that is not the right to have that. But we always do that. So Naju Gumba Drupchen, you know, early morning, really, the early morning, like the, when we need to go to giving, that morning, the taking out the blessings, that time they a little bit warmer than other days, because people stay outside, because I worried that people cannot stay outside because it's so cold that time. Then they say, I'm not there. Sprinkle, when we taking the blessing out, they say they sprinkle, no rain, very like drizzling. But then I didn't feel because I'm in the room in the hall. Then like that. So this is some stories. Yeah. So they have, you know, individual stories. They have many. So that's why Guru Rinpoche is alive. You really all want to practice. The difficult part is we don't have no trust. We don't have no trust to ourselves. We don't have no trust 100% to parents. We don't have no 100% trust to friends. Honestly speaking, we don't never trust to anybody, isn't it? So how we can learn untrust person to get 100% trust, that's something that I never heard about it. Do you understand what, you know, where we are? You know, really, it's a tough thing when you carefully. So, how to relate it with Guru Rinpoche? You know, his teaching is profound, his practice is profound. You have really good practice and devotion and 100% trust. You know, you really get good results. And he's not past tense. his ongoing present. So that is the differences. Good to read life stories of Guru Rinpoche. Yes, they have many supernatural powers. He has supernatural powers. You don't. I don't. Does not mean Guru Rinpoche should not. Right? So, that is my answer. I think the idea of spiritual practice, I think you didn't understand well. What does mean spiritual means? What really Buddha taught? First, Buddha says, practice compassion. So practice compassion to who? To you? Yes, of course, this is how we usually always say, you should have compassion to yourself. Yeah, okay, that's fine. But compassion to others. So the actually in the Buddha's teaching, that really, you know, helping other beings with compassion sincerely is a practice. That's why you look at all the generosity, you know, generosity practice, discipline practice, patient practice. When you look carefully, each of elements, they always have related with others. Like for example, like generosity, giving things, giving Dharma teachings, giving life, protecting life, giving life. They're all about others. In discipline, for example, you all have been going to talk about, I think so, like this. Discipline talk about, don't do good, bad actions. To who? To others. Try to do benefit activities. To who? To others. So what are you talking about? You doing something to benefit others, that is actually the spiritual path. But you think spiritual path is just sitting down and practicing some compassion. Yes, but that compassion, how you know how pure that compassion is? How you know? Because you need to practice, you know, for me it's like that, you know, to able to practice the compassion in daily life. It's tough job. Sitting in a one room, people gives you the food, and you practice compassion, it's much easier. No dealing with anybody else. Everybody let them suffer. It's okay, fine, by practicing from my room to you. That's fine. But one crazy man there saying that I'm dying, please help me, and you don't want to help because he's crazy. You know, really, you need to think. So now the question is not the spiritual and benefiting other. I don't think this is the question. The question is this. I should sit and practice is better, or I should do something to benefit others? So my answer is this. Try to do a little bit both. Okay? You should have some time to practice, practice. But then try to do something benefit others. And you can see the limitation of yourself. You're going to see the challenges. You're going to see things that you don't generally see. Then it's very important. Do you understand? Like, the person who is a very decent person, when he gets the power in politics, he becomes the same bad people who has in the past on the same place, you become like that. Why? Because you didn't begin with that idea, but you become that. That is your limitation. Likewise, compassion is like that. You start doing it, you see the challenges, you see the limitation. Then you again, you know how to look at, you sit down, you meditate, you practice, you supplicate. Again, you do a little bit more, then you come back, practice. You always need to balance. But you are a really good practitioner. You are a really good, high realized, you know, true practitioner. You are a really great practitioner like that. Then your teachers or whatever. Then you want to benefit beings, then it's fine. You know, and of course, in the beginning, you need to practice yourself, you know. But then, what does it mean of, that means I should not do anything to benefit others? No. You should do it. You know? But how much you do it, you check yourself. First, have respect. Be generous. Be disciplined. Be patient, be diligent, be kind mind. be knowledgeable. Sometime understand, sometime explain, sometime stay a little distant, sometimes very loving, you know, like manageable. Okay? The most important, how you really have respect, and the most important, I think, is compassion. Compassion with respect. And you really can do it, pure perception. Seeing the partner is similar like Buddha. You can't. So don't try to ask me that answer. Right? So I'm going to make you sad. When I say you should see your, you know, like a Buddha, and you're not seeing it, or somebody some crazy enough to see it, and he says, I see it, so he's just lying it. So I don't know what you go into it. But basically, the decent level that we can try to practice is compassion. And you really can do it, compassion with detachment, that is tough. Compassion with pure perception, that is tough. Now don't talk about the yoga tantric thing, because I think it's not the point. But my answer is be compassionate and respectful. Eye open, eye close. In the beginning, you can try both. What nature? For me, the most important nature is this. Five senses is open. Okay? But your mind is not wing. Okay? The door of distraction is open, but your mind is not distracted. That is meditation. Yeah? So keeping the door of attachment open, but your mind not attached, that is meditation. Yeah? Open the door of the wisdoms, okay? But your mind don't have no thought arises, that is meditation. Yeah? So the five senses included mouth and, you know, the tongue, you know, and eye, wide open, you know? So it's a much more effective than close eye. Close eye is a little easier sometimes, but generally try both, it's better. No. Yeah, supplication you can do, lie down, no problem. I said that before many times, very clearly. People always ask, people don't listen exactly what I'm saying. You always listen what you like to listen. You never listen what I try to say. What I said is, holding the mala in your hand, okay, I'm going to repeat again. Holding the mala in your hand, lying down like a vampire, okay? Lying down like a vampire. I mean, like, no, like coffin, you lying down, sleep, like, no? Vampire. Holding the mala like that, then you're chanting it to counting. That is not nice to do it. Reason behind is that mantra becomes like a stupa and press you down. But that is mentioned in the text because it gives you description. You can chant the mantra, you can chant and sleep, no problem. But holding the mala and you're really counting it to recite and lying down and holding the mala in the chest. Right? Of course, you know, I'm not saying it's bad, basically. People who are serious to go to retreat and doing that, and I'm asking, saying, don't do that. Why? Because many masters mention about it. But you are just normal, decent person. You are old. You cannot sit upright. You have backache. You always need to lie down. Then it's fine, it's okay, you know. I had a big debate with some Kembo saying that, why, how, you know, you tell these things. It's not me I'm saying it, you know. It's master, the great master says. So you're chanting the mantra, holding like this, lie down, not good. But chanting the mantra without using mala, just, why not? It's allowed to do that. when you not sit, practice more. Number one. Number two, when you not sick, imagine and try to think back what is the weaknesses that you had when you sick, you're not able to practice. Remember that, remind that, then you practice. Don't forget that. Remember how you struggle when you have pain, not able to practice. Remember the pain, then you practice. Then you able to practice after when you have pain, better. The best is practice compassion little bit tonglen, very simple tonglen, little bit compassion practice is always good. I think the first of all, sangha is very important because we always need good friendship. We always need a reminder and motivator and role models. Always, I give you an example. When I went to retreat, and there are many retreatants. So everybody wake up 2:30 in the morning, 2:30 a.m. Then you can hear the drum in three. Tang 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 tak tak sing sing tak 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 like that, you know. So you don't want to sleep on the bed because you feel motivated, saying that they're all waking up everywhere, all the corners of the rooms, and you lying down, you feel like it's not right, you know. You don't feel right, right? So you really try to push yourself and try to, you know. You play the drum. That is the sangha. Sangha means to give you good motivating, give you good examples, or sometimes support your practice. Sangha is very big, broad name. You know, sangha means platform who are gathering practitioners, support each other. That is sangha. So, like I give you an example, when you look at in Asia, sangha means practitioner, sangha means monk, sangha means nun, sangha means like that. When you look at the Asia, no? Monks and nuns, for example, practitioners, you know, stay. They can stay monkhood a little bit more comfortable because they have a monastery. They have a monk's quarter, you know? They prepare the food in the kitchen. They will prepare for you guys, the monks and nuns, to able to stay. But now you go to West, you don't have that, not many places. They have some, you know, in France, I saw that some temples have monks and all like that, and some places in Europe, or I hope, in some US, I think, but not many. So the monkhood, they're always easy to disrupt. They go somewhere else and they disturb right away because they don't have the support system. Like for example, you go to retreat, for example, you know, anybody who decide to go to retreat in a mountain here in Nepal, there are many Buddhist villages and everybody knows that you're doing retreat and, you know, they know that you don't have no much food. I guarantee you, they're going to bring to you. They give you donation of food because they know the value of people who practice. That is the generally lay sangha supporting the practitioner sanghas. And the practitioner sangha, how they support the lay sangha, is first receiving the gifts for the people because they don't have no time to practice. So they want to give whatever they have, they make, to offer to the sangha, to able to let them use so they can get the aspiration and the dedication and the merit and some part of the practice they've done. So the Meladepa said that people who support the retreatants and the retreaters, when the retreater enlighten, the supporter who is supporting the retreatants, they're enlightened together. That is the dependent origination. So Meladepa explained like that. So one of my Kempo teacher, he explained to me, he said that you offer to the Buddha Dharma Sangha. He said, Buddha Dharma Sangha, you always have a merit to have off, you know, merit from offering. But you don't have no merit of using. Because Buddha statue never drink the water. Text never drink the water. But you give the water to the Sangha, the monk or nun or practitioner, they drink the water. So you get two merit. Because you offering the water, you get one merit. Because they're using it for you, that is second merit. That is explained in the Vinaya from the Buddha. Buddha tell the monks, when you have ropes, become old, don't throw away. You mix with the mud, then you pledge, you know, throw in the monasteries. Because monastery at that time, I think, is a mud kind of house. So you put the mud with the cloth, mix, and you make a pack with the monastery. So that temple, that shrine, that used by the Sangha, until that they use, you get the merit. Buddha explained like that. So the offering to the Buddha and Dharma and Sangha, that's why in Asia you see more wanting to support the monks. Because they know that teachings of the Buddhas, they always say that you have offering merit and they have using merit. Because they apply, they use it. So that's why it's very important that Sangha is a really good system. Now family Sangha, for example, so you have father, you know, you are a young man, you practitioner, you really like Dharma, and you get married, then you have a child, and your wife is practitioner too. So you have three child, and you discuss with children, you discuss with the wife, saying that, okay, you know, we're not able to become monk, we're not able to spend our life to practice, but we want to see one of the child do that. So you ask the child says, yes, the elder one says, I want to become practitioner. So right away you decide, bring to the monastery and you give to the monastery, say, please train that my son to be practitioner. Now that is a sangha, family sangha. You support the whole big sangha through your children become a practitioner. So you know when you die on the bed, who comes to you to pray? Your own son or your own daughter coming to your bed, praying very hard because you are your own son. So they have a compassion to you very easily. And they're going to practice so hard to you. That is that gift. So you think that Sangha is not just one person or two friends, three friends. Sangha is village. Sangha is one person, friendship, friends. Sangha is familyhood. Sangha is support system. You know, some rich Sangha support the poor Sangha. Like that. Sangha is a very big word. But basically, Sangha means to flourish together, to support each other, to flourish the Dharma, to able to practice Dharma truthfully. That is a Sangha. And really need it? I think so. It's very important. How to start? From yourself. You want to really start Dharma to go to your own country with the right way? You need to begin to have truthful Sangha to begin from you. You see? Do you understand? So that is what I want to say about the Sangha thing. I think is a Westerner is not the point of retreat. I think Westerner, I think you don't know what is really Dharma is. Because Dharma, I discuss a lot of time, many teachers, about how we should talk about this. See, that is sometimes it's culture influence, sometimes is individually path. Is I think it's both. In the West, I think you have a very individual, I think everybody is same. Individualize, it's all same. You know, in Asia, you have some people who don't believe, some people believe, some people stupid, some smart. In the West, it's similar like that. Individually, no. But in the culturally, in Asia, we have very strong idea of karma. Somehow, we know that karma is something. We don't know how to explain. You ask many public people, they don't have no explanation. bad explanation. But in the West, karma is very new. You have no trust with karma, honestly speaking. So how are you going to be able to practice who have no belief in karma? Do you understand? The fundamental is that. Do you ever heard teacher giving really, really try to push Western student to have idea of karma? Very hardly. What do you hear? Dzogchen, nature of mind, meditation, shamatha, mindfulness, yes. You ever heard about devotion? No. Really people talk about deity publicly? No. Really people talk about karma? No. Much. Of course, they go through the four mind changings and explain a little bit of karma, this, karma, this, karma, that. But you always have doubt. You don't have that determined. Individually in Asia, many. But culturally, Asia have this, this generally belief, you know, don't do bad, you're going to suffer later. They always have that kind of idea, you know. Not so deep-rooted, I think. Nowadays, new age, I don't know. But the generation, like a little bit above my generation, they always have that same idea. But you ask them, what is karma, what is that? They don't have no much answer, but they have very basic answer. Don't do bad. You do bad, you're going to suffer with that result, you know. But in the West, I don't think so, it's not yet that. So the whole idea of Dharma practice is based on karma, one way. When you talk about dependent origination, it's karma. You want to go retreat, why? That is based on karma. That is number one. Number two, yeah, you go to retreat. But then, how sincere you are? How many practitioners who go to retreat and come out becomes sincere? You go to retreat and come out, I think it's one of the major questions that I like to answer. I like to ask this question. It doesn't matter West or East. This is a general question I like to answer. Going to retreat, coming out, you become worse. People look value down the retreat. Do you understand? So it is individually path. Retreat is important. I think it's one of the most important retreat. How long you should go? In the beginning, try 1 day, 1 week, 10 days, month is good. 3 months, okay. But don't go too long alone. Because one day you become bored, one day you're going to give up like that. Because you don't have the karma strong base. You have strong karma base, you're never going to give up like that. Because you always have in the mind, I should not do that. But because you don't have no trust in karma, okay, I'm fed up with the practice. I try my best for 3 years, nothing happened, forget it. I'm going to go with something else. Because the whole idea, you don't have the idea, the base, you know. I'm telling this not because of discourage you guys, okay. I'm just talking about this because you really need to get this idea. And individually, I think everybody going through this tough job about karma, right? That's why I like to say that. You understand? Something like that. I think I didn't answer your real question, but wherever you do retreat doesn't matter. One way matter. Because many masters says good to practice wherever the past master practice. You know, so past master practice mostly, you know, Nepal, some part of Sikkim, Bhutan, Tibet, India. You know, some place that we know, some places we don't know how where they practice. So it's good to practice the places where you can do. But sometimes we have problem with visa like that, then you try to do, go your own country and practice there better, yeah? It doesn't matter. I think both, my answer is both. Practice the good, great master practice, people practice place, and try to meditate, practice wherever you are in from.